الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أرسله الله بالحق بشيرا ونذيرا بين يدي ساعة من أطاع الله ورسوله فقد رشد واهتدى ومن يعصهما فإنه لا يضر إلا نفسه ولا يضر الله شيئا وسيجزي الله الشاكرين أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ومن يقتل مؤمنا متعمدا فجزاؤه جهنم خالدا فيها وغضب الله عليه ولعنه وأعد له عذابا عظيما صدق الله العظيم. My respected brothers and sisters, we just came out of the month of Ramadan al-Mubarak, and as the fasting Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we were required to learn the lesson of patience, of self-discipline, of mutual respect, of mutual mercy and love. And instead of learning an excuse which the Prophet taught us, فَإِنْسَابَهُ أَحَدْ وَقَاتَلَهُ أَحَدْ فَلْيَقُلْ إِنِّي صَائِمٌ, that if anybody abuses a Muslim during the month of Ramadan, or tries to fight or even kill him or her, the response of a true Muslim is, I will not fight back, I will not abuse you because I am fasting. But I do not know what's wrong with the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that just 1 week after the month of Ramadan, there are hundreds and thousands of people being killed. Not by the Jews, not by the Christians, not by the Hindus, not by the Buddhists, by their own so-called Muslim brothers and sisters. It is an alarming situation in Syria. Even today, over 50 people are killed in Damascus, and no count of what's going on in Aleppo and Daraa and other areas. Yesterday, we have seen all of what is going on in Pakistan, and what has been going through the month of Ramadan, where people who went to offer Salat al-Jum'ah or offer Salat al-Taraweeh were butchered by the suicide bombers, these so-called Muslims who thought that they were serving the cause of Islam and killing those people who disagreed with them on some sectarian issues. And we have been seeing what has been happening in Egypt. An elected president is deposed by the army, and since then the army, which is supposed to protect them from external enemies, is the one who is shooting live at them just because they have got the right to demonstrate and they are exercising that right. And all of us, we have seen that over 2,000 people were killed the other day in Rabia al-Adawiyya and Nahda. And today, before I left the office for khutbah, I was watching Al Jazeera. And as we talk right now, the army Apache helicopters are firing bullets upon the people who are demonstrating in Maidan al-Ramses. Over 41 people are dead right now while the helicopters are still firing at the demonstrators. What is wrong? Where is the Quran? Where is the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? And where are our fundamentals? We are so much worried about ibadah, focus upon salah and zakah, and all of our TV stations were talking in the month of Ramadan about what is going to nullify fasting or what is going to be, mashallah, preserving the fasting of a Muslim. We are so much worried about the sunnah and the mubahat and some of the bid'ah that our TV stations were so much focused upon all of these small issues. But nobody was talking about the bigger issue, the kabair. The kabair, there is no question, no if and but, and no second opinion when it comes to the mufassireen or the fuqaha. Allah, my brothers and sisters, I truly believe that we have compromised our religion. We have mixed up our priorities. The kabair are not being talked about, and the bid'ah and khurafat are the center, are the focus of our discussions. And somehow the basic message of the Quran is taken as for granted. And we are so much focused upon minute issues that we even seldom talk about these major issues as if they are universally agreed upon by the Muslims. Yes, many Muslims, they talk about these issues, but somehow they have not internalized it. That's the reason that for smallest political issues, they are ready to kill themselves. I'm sure you must have seen what happened in Beirut yesterday. So what I'm trying to say is that it is important for us, the Muslims, to go back to our roots and start reminding our ummah of the basic fundamental rights and the duties, and also the other areas which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has clearly made haram, so that all of us we know that we will not be able to enter Jannah or receive the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if we are able to commit even one of those kabair. And the ayah of Surah An-Nisa, which I have recited before you, it starts actually the ayah before that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ أَنْ يَقْتُلَ مُؤْمِنًا إِلَّا خَطَأً. That is impossible for a true believer to kill another believer except in a mistaken fashion. There's no way a true believer would ever kill another believer intentionally. And then also subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the punishment or the expiation or kafara if a person unintentionally kills another Muslim. And then the ayah culminates in the ayah which I recited before you, وَمَنْ يَقْتُلْ مُؤْمِنًا مُتَعَمِّدًا. And whosoever kills a single mu'min intentionally, any mu'min, does not matter a person who is, mashallah, from Sahaba or from the righteous people, as long as that person is a believer who says, La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as the Prophet wasalam, in one of the authentic hadith said, مُتْعَمِّدًا فَجَزَاؤُهُ جَهَنَّمُ خَالِدًا فِيهِ. The recompense for that premeditated murder is what? جَهَنَّمُ خَالِدًا فِيهَا, for eternity. One murder, one intentional murder of a true believer, the jaza for that is eternal hellfire. وَغَضِبَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَلَعَنَهُ. And that person has earned the rage, the ghadab, the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the curse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَأَعَدَّ لَهُ عَذَابًا عَظِيمًا. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prepared for that murderer the chastising punishment. Now there are five curses in this ayah, five punishments in this ayah. One punishment is sufficient for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to say that that person is condemned to hellfire forever. And hellfire is not something easy. If somebody goes over there, bi'sa al-masir, bi'sa al-mihad, the worst of the abode you can ever imagine. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes further than that. Khalidan fiha, for eternity. Ya Allah, that is sufficient. But not only that, that punishment is going to be there for eternity, that punishment is going to be accompanied with the ghadab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with the rage of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, sometimes we have seen people beating other people, or sometimes even beating the children. There's one way to punish them. There's another way to punish them with anger and ghadab, rage. And imagine the rage of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then not only rage, when a person is cursing astaghfirullah and using foul language, that is the utmost expression of anger, la'na. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not be punishing them only in Jahannam, burning them in the hellfire. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will do it with the ghadab. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will also keep on cursing them. May the curse be upon you. I created that person with my own hand, with the hands of my mercy. I created him or her from the dust and then took care of him or her for 9 months in the womb of their mother. I was the Khalid, I was the Bari, I was the Musawwir. I put everybody's shape with my own hands of mercy. I did not let anybody to decide what type of nose and eyes and face that person is going to be going. I put so much planning into bringing that person into this field. And then I said, وَرَكَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمْ. We have honored all the children of Adam because they have got the soul from me. They were part of me, not on the ontological level, not in the being sense, but being that the ruh was from me. فَإِذَا صَفَّيْتُهُ وَنَفَخْتُ فِيهِ بِالْرُوحِ. And I knew each one of them by name. Before sending them into world, I made the arrangement for them to have the sustenance in their proper name. And I loved each one of them more than their mothers. As the hadith of Rasulullah said, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created 99 points or 100 points of mercy and love, out of which He has given one to the entire existence and kept 99 for Himself. And 1% the mothers, they love their children and all of the love which is taking place in the world. So I love them more than their mother, and they were the apples of my eye. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not have the eye. And here you, the one who did not create him, who did not provide for him, who did not give him or her the risk, just killed him with live bullets because they did not agree to your coup, because they did not agree to your regime, because they did not agree to your political ideology, because they expressed their opinion and in peaceful manner. And what a hypocrisy, wallahi, my brothers and sisters, and truly hypocrisy, that this nonsense is taking place over there in the name of Shah. When they want people to come out, the army is inviting everybody, the army which is supposed to be for all Egyptians, inviting everybody to come out and using all of their resources, even closing the TV programs and all of those musalsalat, so that people come out. When their people come out, this is the opinion of the Shah, Irada of the Shah. When the others come out, that they have got their elected president, a democratically elected president, and they are peacefully demonstrating over there, this is Irhab, this is terrorism. No, this is not terrorism. The terrorism is what these CCN cronies are doing. This is haram. We are not supporting any party against any party. Wallahi, we are not causing the kind of rift between the community. Wallahi, my brothers and sisters, when you see those people fasting, doing their salat in jamaat, and then they are being killed, men, women, and children, by the live shots, and then those who are wounded are being shot by the police, and those who are killed, their dead bodies are in the makeshift hospital over there in Rabi Adawiyah. And then the army back police goes and shoots those who are injured, shoots the tear gas canisters over there, and then goes and shoots the firebomb and burns those dead bodies. Tell me, are they Ilah? Are they God that they are killing and burning people alive? Don't they know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, قَضِبَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَلَعَنَهُ وَأَعَدَّ لَهُ عَذَابٍ عَظِيمًا. وَاللَّهِ سُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ. Those people who are intentionally killing the believers, they are the la'in, they have got the ghadab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take the revenge from them in this dunya and like Fir'aun in Akhirah. There is no Islam after that. No Islam. So therefore this discussion should start that this is between the Muslims. No, this is between Kufr and Islam. Because the Prophet has made it very much clear. كُلُّ ذَنْبٍ عَصَى اللَّهُ وَيَغْفِرَهُ. The Prophet said, every sin Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may forgive. Except that if a person kills a believing man or woman, a person, believing person, that person would never be forgiven. Abir rajul yamutu kafiran, or the person dies as a non-believer, as a kafir. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala al-Habib has equated a kafir with that person who intentionally kills a mu'min. So for me, those people who are intentionally killing Muslims in Syria, in Pakistan, in Egypt, wherever Muslims are, and they say, La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they have not caused any kind of murder, or spread the mischief in the world, or they have not gone to the court, and the court, after the due process, has given them the punishment for murder, then killing them, as the Quran says, is equal to killing the entire humanity. And Allah, my brothers and sisters, if you go back to the Quran, you find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knew that human beings have got the tendency to kill just because of envy, because of the issue of power, because they could do it. وَقْلُ عَلَيْهِ لَا بَعْبْنِ آدَمُ بِالْحَرْبِ إِذْ قَرَّبَا قُرْبَانًا فَتُقُبِّلَ مِنْ أَحَدِهِمَا وَلَمْ تُتَقَبَّلْ مِنَ الْآخَرِ قَالَ لَأَقْتُلَنَّكَ قَالَ إِنَّمَا يَتَقَبَّلُ اللَّهُ مِنَ الْمُتَّقِينَ. لئن بسطت إليه يدك لتقتلني ما أنا بباسط يدي إليك ليقتلك إني أخاف الله رب العالمين. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us the story of Habil and Qabil, the two children of Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. And because of envy, because of jealousy, because he wants to get something which is not belonging to him, he decides to kill the other brother. فبعث الله غرابا يبحث في الارض ليريه كيف يواري سوءات اخيه فاصبح من النادمين. من اجل ذلك كتبنا على بني اسرائيل انه من قتل نفسا بغير نفس او فساد في الارض فكانما قتل الناس جميعا ومن احياها فكانما احيا الناس جميعا. From the beginning of the humanity, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promulgated this law that if somebody kills one human being, that's not even Muslim, man qatala nafsan bighayri nafs, anybody who has got the soul, and that soul is the gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a common denominator to all humanity, taking one soul unjustly is equal to killing the entire humanity, and saving one soul is equal to saving the entire humanity. Now within humanity, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his Habib alayhi salatu wasalam has made the massacre or the killing of Muslims the worst kind of kabair. A kabira which is closer to shirk and kufr. And I gave you the hadith which equates the kufr and the intentional murder of Muslim. In the other hadith, in Sahih al-Bukhari, very authentic hadith, the Prophet ﷺ was asked, Ya Rasulullah ﷺ, ma hiya akbarul kabair? What are the highest, or you can say, the gravest of all the grave sins? The Prophet ﷺ said, al-ishraku billah. The gravest of the sins which is not going to be forgiven is to commit shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inna Allah la yaghfiru an yushraka bihi wa yaghfiru ma duna dhalika liman yasha. Shirk is not going to be forgiven. So what happens? What is the next one, Ya Rasulullah said? Wa qatlu an-nafs. To kill a soul. To kill a soul, not even a Muslim soul. To kill a soul is on borderline with shirk. The second gravest sin. What is the third one? Wa hukukul walidain. Being undutiful or disrespectful to one's parents who brought them into this existence. Who brought them and basically took care of them, to show disrespect to them, disloyalty to them, not to take care of them. This is the punishment or the sins which will never be forgiven by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa qawlu zur. And to give false statement or false witness. To go to the court and make these kind of false accusations. This is also from the Kabair. The other hadith, the Prophet ﷺ, he said, لَنْ يَزَالُ الْمُؤْمِنُ فِي فُسْحَةٍ مِنْ دِينِ مَا لَمْ يُسِفْ دَمًا حَرَامًا. A Muslim, a person, remains within the parameters of Islam, parameters of deen, as long as he or she does not shed a blood which is made haram, which is sacred in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I can tell you whose blood is more sacred. You know, even the last statement of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam on Hijjat al-Wida, he is looking at Kaaba. He is very close to Masjid al-Haram. He is standing on the day of Arafat, which is the most sacred day of the year for a Muslim. He asks them, which day is today? Which city is this one? And which shahr or which month is this one? أي يوم يكون هذا؟ وأي شهر يكون هذا؟ وأي بلد يكون هذا؟ He said, Ya Rasulullah, today is the day of Arafah, the most sacred day of the year. We are in Balad al-Haram, Kaaba al-Makkah, and we are in Shahr al-Haram, Zilhajjah. So the Prophet ﷺ said, My God, in whose hand is my life? Inna amwalakum wa dima'akum wa a'radakum a'radakum haramun alaykum ka hurmati yawmikum hadha fi baladikum hadha wa fi shahrikum hadha. Your blood, your property and your honor and dignity is as sacred, as sanctified, as haram upon you as the sanctity of this God, as the sacredness of this month, and the sacredness of Balad al-Haram. I do not know, we keep on going there 5 million, 6 million, 3 million, 10 million every year for Umrah and Hajj. And we are so careful not to kill a mosquito or not kill an insect, because killing an insect in the vicinity of Kaaba while you have not the Ihram will nullify your Umrah or will nullify your Hajj. But somehow, all of us are not condemning what is happening in the Muslim Ummah, where hundreds and thousands are being killed. And somehow we have taken it for granted, as long as I am doing my Salah, as long as I am doing my Zakah and Hajj, maybe that mistake is for somebody else. But wallahi, my brothers and sisters, remember one thing. Until as the Ummah, we change the situation from within, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not going to change it for us. We have to bring these kind of fundamentals to our society, to our discussion, where all of us feel that if one Muslim is killed in any part of the world, the entire Muslim community must feel and should feel the pain. I don't feel, and I do not know why Muslims are not learning from the other nations. We have got the same kinds of discussions taking place in Jewish theology, in Jewish understanding. For them also, killing a Jew is equal to killing the entire community. and a person would not receive salvation. We have talked about it so much. We have given so much focus upon this issue that it has become a taboo in the Jewish community to kill another Jew. You will rarely hear like what happened to the Prime Minister of Israel, but that is very rare nowadays in the history of the modern Jew. But we have got the Quran, the Sunnah of Rasulullah. Why don't we talk about these things in our order? Our more focus is upon furu'ah, upon the petty, nitty-gritty issues, those issues which are of not relevance to our practical life. But because talking about these issues costs us something, it may hurt the feeling of somebody, or may challenge the dictators or the people who have got the power. So we are afraid to say our thoughts, and we are afraid to talk about these things. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask us on the day of judgment that you are so much focused upon nitty-gritties, but the blood of the Muslims are being shed all over. What did you do? Anyhow, and Abdullah bin Amr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, anna Nabi sallam qaal, la zararu dunya ahwanu ala Allahi min qatli rajulin muslim. Pay attention to this hadith. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, la zararu dunya ahwanu ala Allahi min qatli rajulin muslim. To actually that if the whole existence is destroyed, or to lose whatever is in the heavens and the earth in dunya, is easier for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept than the murder or unjustified murder of a single believer. So all of those people who are being killed left and right, do you think they are pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? He is walking in happiness over there. Wallahi, the Arsh al-Rahman, the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, shivers when one soul is mercilessly killed for none of their mistakes. And Ali ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu قال يجيء المقتول بالقاتل يوم القيامة ناصيته ورأسه بيده وعضاته تشرب دما يقول يا ربي قتلني قتلني هذا حتى يدري من العرش. On the day of judgment, and actually the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is clear, أول ما يقرأ بين الناس بالدماء, that the first thing which is going to be made accountable on the day of judgment is the issues of murders, the blood related crime. The person who has been unjustly killed will come on the day of judgment, will carry his head on his head, and the blood will be coming from all over him. He will grab the qatil, the murderer, take him to the Arsh al-Rahman. Close, remember, there is the istihara in this hadith. That person will be given the access to go directly to the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hatta yudnihi min al-Arsh. Imagine. I mean, if somebody has got the direct access to, you know, White House, and there is a crime, you can imagine what's going to be happening. So that person will carry the qatil and say, Ya Allah, hada qatalan. Ya Allah, asking, why did he kill me? This is the person who took my life, Ya Allah. And from there, the ghadab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the la'na of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the chastising punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will start for that person, and that person will never come out of Jahannam. And I'm going to conclude it. My brothers and sisters, one hadith. And it is truly, truly a very, very significant hadith. And Abi Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, من أعان على قتل مؤمن ولو بشطر كلمة لقي الله عز وجل مكتوب بين عينيه آئس من رحمة الله. Not only that a person kills somebody, if somebody assists another human being, even by means of his words, one word, you did good, you can do it, he deserves it. In any way or form, assisting or helping a person to kill a mu'min, on the day of judgment, the Prophet ﷺ said, that person will appear in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala And between his two eyes or her two eyes will be written eyes in Rahmatillah. The person who has got no hope to receive the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he says, La taqnatu bi rahmatillah. He says, Qul ya ibadiy allazeena asrafu ala anfusihim, La taqnatu bi rahmatillah. But you are uttering one word. Wallahi, I advise everybody, wallahi, my brothers and sisters, forget about political issues. We are not talking about politics. But all of us, as the Ummah of Muhammad, should have no hesitation whatsoever to condemn the violence, to condemn the killing of innocent human beings by anybody, and to express our dismay and our condemnation to hold the world that we are not forgiving, and especially for the killings of those brothers and sisters who are fasting, who are observing the mashallah salawat, and peaceful demonstrated, doing nothing except expressing their freedom of expression. They should have not been killed, and if it does not stop, the entire ummah should take the same kind of step. This is haram, this is haram, this is haram, and ya Allah, be witness that we do not condone it. Aqulu qawli hadha. أستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم.